In this video, we'll cover the top 10 mistakes ASP.NET Core Web API developers still make, even after years of building APIs. If you're learning through an ASP.NET Core course or following a .NET Core API tutorial, this video will seriously level up your understanding. Let's dive in. Mistake number one, ignoring proper HTTP status codes. In many ASP.NET Core Web API tutorials, you'll notice developers returning a 200 OK status for everything, even when the request actually fails. For instance, if the login credentials are incorrect, we shouldn't return a 200 OK response. That's misleading and doesn't reflect what really happened. Instead, we should return an unauthorized response to clearly indicate that the login attempt failed due to invalid credentials. Now, if I test the same login method again, you'll see that we're receiving the correct status code. This is one of the key ASP.NET Core API security best practices. Mistake number two, exposing domain models directly. In any real-world ASP.NET Core Web API project, you should avoid sending your actual database entities directly to the client. For example, when using a GET method, we should never expose sensitive fields like passwords. Instead, we should use DTOs, data transfer objects, to control exactly what data gets sent in the response. In this new GetUserDTO class, I'm including only the properties that need to be exposed to the client. Then, in the controller, rather than returning an array of entity objects, I'll return an array of DTO objects instead. As a result, the API response now contains only the necessary properties, nothing more, nothing less. Mistake number three, trying to send a body with a GET request. In this example, I've included the search parameters in the request body of a GET method. And yes, it works fine when tested in Postman. You'll see a successful response. But this approach is actually incorrect. If you test the same method using Swagger, you'll notice an error message saying request with get or head method cannot have body. The correct way to handle this is by passing the values as query parameters. It's cleaner, follows standard conventions, and works perfectly with any ASP.NET Core API controller. Mistake number four, not validating user input. In any .NET Core API project, skipping model validation can lead to broken features, security issues, or data inconsistencies. Let's take the create method as an example, which is responsible for adding a new user to the database. In the create user DTO, we should define all the necessary validation rules. And before proceeding, we should always check if the model state is valid. If it's not valid, we return an error response. In this example, I'm returning all the validation errors in the response. Now, let's try executing the method without providing the first name. As you can see, the validation error is clearly shown in the response. Let's test again by leaving multiple fields blank. And this time, you'll see all validation errors listed in the response, just as expected. Mistake number five, poor exception handling. A clean ASP.NET Core API project should never expose internal stack traces to the client. For instance, I've created a simple controller named Error Controller that returns a basic error message. Now, by using centralized exception handling with middleware, we can catch unhandled exceptions and return user-friendly and safe error responses. If you check the response in Postman, you'll see that it displays a clean and simple error message without exposing any internal stack traces. Mistake number six, misconfiguring cores. If you're working on a frontend that connects to your ASP.NET Core Web API and the requests suddenly start getting blocked, then cores is most likely the problem. Make sure you configure cores properly so that your ASP.NET Core API controllers can be accessed from the allowed origins. Correct cores configuration ensures smooth communication between your frontend and backend without unexpected access issues. Mistake number seven, hardcoding your service dependencies. One of the most powerful features in ASP.NET Core is its built-in dependency injection system. Instead of using new everywhere in your code, you should inject your services through constructors. This approach not only makes your code more testable and maintainable, but it's also considered a best practice when working with .NET Core APIs. Mistake number 8, returning too much data. If your ASP.NET Core API controller is returning full object graphs when the frontend only needs a few fields, that's a clear red flag. Let's say your user entity contains a long list of properties, but all the frontend actually needs is the first name and last name. In such cases, we can create a method that returns only the required fields. This API method accepts a username and returns just the first name and last name, nothing more. By doing this, we reduce payload size, improve performance, and keep the response clean and efficient. Mistake number 9, not implementing pagination. Let's say we have a large amount of data in our database. If we don't implement pagination, this get method will return the entire list, which is inefficient and slow. To solve this, we can include two parameters, page index and page size. Adding pagination makes your API faster, more scalable, and much friendlier to client applications. Here, we pass the parameter values, and as you can see, it returns only 5 results, the number we specified in page size. To fetch the next set of data, we simply change the page index. Mistake number 10, skipping authorization on sensitive endpoints. If you're building an ASP.NET Core Web API authentication system or handling any kind of admin level operations, it's crucial to use the Authorize attribute. In our demo project, only users with the administrator role should be allowed to perform create, update, and delete operations. Right now, I'm logged in as a regular user. As expected, I'm able to execute the get method without any issue. But when I try to perform create, update, or delete, I receive a 403 forbidden error indicating proper role-based access control is in place. You can download the source code used in this tutorial from my Patreon. The link is in the description. Avoiding these mistakes will not only save you hours of debugging, but also help you build clean, secure, and scalable APIs that follow real-world .NET Core API best practices. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to the channel. See you in the next video. Thank you.